All right, folks, thank you all for coming. My name is Michael Hannon. I'm the Speaker's Chair of the Federalist Society, and today we are hosting our debate on the defense of marriage. We have two debaters with us today, Professor Judith Stacey here from NYU in the Sociology Department, and Mr. Ryan Anderson, who's a Heritage Fellow down in DC. To begin with introductions, Professor Stacey, as I've said, is a professor of social and cultural analysis and sociology here at New York University. Her primary focus areas include family studies, gender studies, queer studies, and sexuality. Her book, Unhitched, explores family configurations that deviate from the standard Western concept of marriage. And others of her publications include Brave New Families, Stories of Domestic Upheaval in Late 20th Century America, How Does the Gender of Parents Matter? Ideal Families and Social Science Ideals, How Does the Sexual Orientation of Parents Matter? And New Slants on the Slippery Slope, The Politics of Polygamy and Gay Family Rights in South Africa and the US. Professor Stacey has been involved with the Canadian marriage cases and has filed amicus briefs throughout the US cases as well. She attended the University of Michigan for her bachelor's degree and then went on to receive her Master's of Arts in History from the University of Illinois and her doctorate in sociology from Brandeis. Professor Stacey has previously taught at the University of California at Davis and the University of Southern California before coming here to NYU in 2003. Ryan T. Anderson is the William E. Simon Fellow at the Heritage Foundation and the editor of Public Discourse, the online journal of the Witherspoon Institute of Princeton, New Jersey. Mr. Anderson is co-author of the book, What is Marriage? Man and Woman, a Defense, and of the article, What is Marriage? That appeared in the Harvard Journal of Law and Public Policy. Mr. Anderson and his co-authors filed amicus briefs with the First and Ninth Circuit Courts and with the United States Supreme Court on the challenges to California's Proposition 8 and the Federal Defense of Marriage Act. His articles have appeared in the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, First Things, the Weekly Standard, National Review, the New Atlantis, and the Claremont Review of Books. He has also made appearances on Piers Morgan Live, CNN Newsroom, and MSNBC. Mr. Anderson graduated from Princeton University Phi Beta Kappa and magna cum laude and is a doctoral candidate in political philosophy at the University of Notre Dame. So the way we'll set up this debate is we're going to begin with 20-minute segments for each of our speakers, and then two 10-minute rebuttal periods, and then we'll open it up to all of your questions. So without further ado, Mr. Ryan Anderson.
Great. Thank you, Michael, and thank you for coming to this. It's great to do this at a law school because as a place of higher education, a place of academic learning, we can avoid some of the name calling and sloganeering that I think both sides of this debate frequently resort to, and we can both have a seat at the table and speak from a podium and examine the assumptions and the dogmas on both sides. I think, before I go further, I'll say what I'm not saying today. I'm not going to discuss morality, their moral views on both sides of this debate, and their moral views both for and against same-sex acts. That's not going to come up today. I'm not going to talk about religion. I think the religious views on both sides of this debate, and I won't be discussing those. And I'm not going to be talking about tradition. There are some conservatives who make a Burkean case that because this is how marriage has been, this is how marriage ought to be. But that's not the argument that I'm going to make. Though I do think it's worth pointing out just as a factoid that up until the year 2000, more or less every political community and religious community that we know of has recognized marriage as a male-female union. And so that calls for an explanation, and that's what I'm going to try to elucidate in the 20 minutes that I have right now. I also won't be talking about sexual orientation or homosexuality in particular. I don't think that cuts one way or the other for the question that I will be discussing, which is what is marriage? So one of the sloppy slogans that I see coming from the other side is the slogan of marriage equality. I think everyone in this debate is for marriage equality. No one is for laws that treat citizens inequally, unequally. No one is for laws that will treat marriages anything but equally. The question, though, is what is marriage? Before you can know whether any given legal policy is treating all marriages in the same way, you have to know what marriage is. And so I see pitfalls for those on the side of redefining marriage in law right now. And it seems to me that they can't answer, one, the traditional marital norms that we in America have recognized since the founding of the nation. Two, they can't account for the harms that would be caused by redefining marriage. And then Three, there are internal contradictions on their account of what marriage is. That if marriage equality demands recognizing same-sex couples, why doesn't marriage equality demand other recognition? So I'll say a brief word about each one of those points and then launch into my positive case for marriage. On the best philosophical account in defense of same-sex marriage that my co-authors and I have been able to find, marriage is set apart from other forms of human relationship by emotional intensity or priority. What makes marriage unique is that it's your number one relationship. That's how John Crivino, a philosopher at Wayne State University, puts it. And he's just written a book with Maggie Gallagher debating same-sex marriage, published this year by Oxford University Press. And I think John Crivino presents the most plausible account of marriage, but I think on his account, it just collapses marriage with companionship. If marriage is an intense emotional union, it seems to me that it doesn't explain why marriage ought to be a permanent union. Emotions can come and can go, they can wax and they can wane. If what sets marriage apart from other forms of human sociability is just the intensity of the emotional commitment, it doesn't seem to me like why in principle it would demand a pledge of permanency, rather than just a pledge to last for as long as the love lasts. Second, it's not clear why it would be sexual, a sexual relationship, and why it would demand sexual exclusivity. Again, if marriage is simply your number one person, as Crivino describes it, and if it's about emotional intimacy and emotional priority, why would it demand sexual exclusivity, and why would it even need to be a sexual relationship in the first place? For some couples, sex and sexual exclusivity may enhance the emotional connection, but for other couples, it may not. And so it seems that even the assumption that it would be a sexual relationship and that the type of exclusivity that marriage would call for, being sexual exclusivity, is called into question on this account of what marriage is. And then lastly, it seems hard to explain why it would be a monogamous relationship. It seems to me that there's nothing unique about the number two, there's nothing magical about the number two. And if what sets marriage apart from other forms of human relationships are the emotional union, emotional priority, you can have an intense emotional relationship with more than one other person. So it seems that it would be arbitrary for the law to demand that marriage just be between two consenting adults. And then lastly, it seems that it can't even explain why the state would be in the marriage business in the first place. The state doesn't recognize my other human relationships, my other forms of friendships, my other forms of cohabitating relationships. Why is the state in the marriage business if marriage per se is just an intense emotional relationship? What hooks the state into regulating this form of human sociability while leaving all other forms of non-commercial human sociability more or less as live and let live? So those are the challenges it seems to me that the other side needs to account for. But also there seem to be internal contradictions in the forms of if the argument is being made as one of marriage equality and that justice demands that the Supreme Court redefine marriage to include same-sex couples, it strikes me that Justice Sotomayor's question to Ted Olson still hasn't been answered. What principle would limit what marriage equality and justice demands? And when Justice Kagan asked the question, or Justice Sotomayor asked the question, she said, I see why maybe age of consent, why we might have a concern for minors. But other than that, she asked, what principle limit could there be on the right, the fundamental right to marriage, if marriage is understood as simply the person that you have the deepest emotional connection with? And she raised explicitly the question of number. So she was wondering, what about plural unions, polyamorous or polygamous or group marriages? And again, it seems to me that if you make an argument for marriage equality for same-sex couples, why doesn't justice and equality demand state recognition of same-sex throuples? And a throuple, as I discovered when we were doing research for the book, is a three-person couple. Newsweek magazine introduced me to that term. And it was New York magazine that introduced me to that term. Newsweek magazine introduced me to the fact that there are 500,000 polyamorous households in America as of the year 2009. So if marriage equality demands state recognition of the same-sex couple, what principle would stop state recognition of the same-sex throuple or the 500,000 polyamorous households? It seems to me that the other side would need to have to answer that question to appease the concerns of Justice Sotomayor. So that said, I'll give a brief account of what I think marriage is, first as a philosophical matter, and then I'll explain why I think government recognizes this particular form of human sociability. I think we can take a lesson from Aristotle right at the beginning of the Politics, when he describes how you can analyze forms of human sociability in terms of the acts that that are committed, the goods that are being pursued, and then the norms that govern the relationship. And on this account, any form of human relationship is governed by certain, is constituted by certain activities in the pursuit of certain common goods in the context of shared commitment. And to give an example of a law school, what makes a law school distinctive as a form of human community, it makes it different than a bowling league or a barbershop or an orchestra, is that we engage in academic action. What does academic action look like? People give lectures, other people take notes, students write term papers, professors grade term papers, professors administer tests, students take tests, professors write books, students write term papers, things like that. Those are the actions. A professor will host office hours, you'll visit office hours, you'll talk about intellectual subjects. What are you pursuing when you engage in these sorts of actions? You're pursuing the good of truth, the good of knowledge. So the various actions that you engage in are ordered towards a certain common good, a discovery of the truth, a refutation of error, a more clearer vision of what is true and good and beautiful. And so it's governed by certain norms that are distinctive of the academic community. You cite all of your sources, you don't plagiarize, you don't cheat on tests. If you're a scientist, you reveal all of the data, not just the data that supports your conclusion. So if you run a study, whether it's in physics or in social science, you don't data mine, you report all of the data so that scientists who may agree or disagree with you can look at the data and reach conclusions in pursuit of the truth. And that's why these norms govern these behaviors in pursuit of these goods. It seems to me that marriage can be analyzed using the same framework. And what's revealed about marriage and what makes marriage different than an academic community, what makes marriage different than an athletic community, is that it's comprehensive. It revolves a comprehensive union of spouses in three ways, with respect to the action that they perform, with respect to the goods that they pursue, and with respect to the norms and the commitments that govern their relationship. So first, it's a comprehensive union in the most basic dimensions of what it unites spouses. It's a union of both hearts and minds, but also, and distinctively, it's a union of bodies. Second, it unites them not just with any particular good, but with a common good of the creation of new human life, and then the raising of that new life to participate in all of the human goods. So it's comprehensive in the range of goods that it's oriented to. And then lastly, it calls for a comprehensive commitment of spouses, regardless of what their tastes or preferences may be, to form a marital-type relationship. It calls for both an exclusive and a permanent relationship, commitment to get that relationship off the ground and running. So what do I mean by this? When I say that marriage is a comprehensive union, so the action that unites spouses in a distinctively marital way and unites them comprehensively, both a union of hearts, minds, and bodies, we might consider what makes the organs of a body a single organism in the first place. What is it that makes my organs united? With respect to most functions, I'm radically complete. Locomotion, digestion, all these things I do as a single individual. And all my various parts, my heart, my lungs, veins and arteries, muscles and skeleton bones, they're all integrated, coordinating towards a common good of the life of my organism. With respect to one function, I'm radically incomplete. A single individual can't engage in one biological function, and that's reproduction. It takes a mated pair to reproduce, and that when the mated pair actually mate, when they unite, it's not just a matter of body parts rubbing or touching or interlocking, they actually form a deep biological union. And that this union, the mated pair in coitus, actually are, objectively speaking, ordered towards a certain good. And that's the good that 9 months later frequently pops out as a new human being. Regardless of what the wishes or the dispositions or the intentions of the individuals, that action itself has an end. The end is the bearing of new life, and then that commitment ought to be one that will then raise that new life to maturity in pursuit of all of the goods. So then lastly, that's why this form of human sociability can objectively call for certain commitments of the spouses. Exclusivity along the sexual dimension. So none of you are cheating on your spouse right now by attending this lecture. The type of exclusivity that marriage calls for isn't intellectual exclusivity. It's not academic exclusivity, but it's sexual exclusivity because the sexual act that unites a man and a woman is distinctive of the marital relationship. And it calls for permanency, both because the rearing of that new life requires the stable commitment of both the mother and the father that created the new life, but also because in order to even form a comprehensive commitment in the first place, you can't have that escape clause. You can't be holding back something of yourself temporally. I give myself to you comprehensively for the next 5 years, and then we'll reconsider. That wouldn't be a comprehensive commitment in the first place. It seems to me that this view of marriage, and we point out in the book, we cite the names I'm about to mention, has been embraced both in ancient philosophy and ancient politics by thinkers like Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Musenius Rufus, and Plutarch. That you find it embodied, this basic vision, in both the canon law, but also the civil law and the common law. And you see it in Enlightenment thinkers such as Kant and Eastern thinkers such as Gandhi. So it's not the particular purview of any given religious, theologic, or philosophic community or tradition. But that the remarkable thing about this is that while most political, religious, and philosophic schools have disagreed on most issues, this is one in which we find a broad range of agreement, at least in broad contours. There will always be disagreement around the edges. That said, in the next, looks like I have 8 minutes left, I want to make an argument for why I think the state cares about marriage. What makes the state interested in the marital relationship? And if the first explanation of what marriage is an ontological, metaphysical, philosophic account, I want to give kind of a social account of what marriage does. For a political community, marriage exists to bring a man and a woman together as husband and wife, to then be mother and father to any children that their union produces. It's about connecting goods and people that otherwise have a tendency to fragment, connecting sex and love, husbands and wives, sex and babies, babies with mothers and fathers. That none of this happens by happenstance. None of this happens by chance. It requires strong cultural signals, and the law can either lend a supporting hand or a destructive hand. And you can think about it in this way. Whenever a child is born, whenever a baby comes into the world, a mother will always be close by. That's a biological reality. The question for us is, will a father be close by? And if so, for how long? And what marriage does is it increases the odds of that man both being committed to the woman with whom he created the child, and then the pair being committed to that child. Marriage is based on the truth that men and women are complementary. It's based on the biological fact that reproduction depends on a man and a woman. It's based on the social reality that children need both a mother and a father. Part of this is based on the reality that there's no such thing as parenting in the abstract. In the book and in our amicus brief, we cite Rutgers sociologist David Popenoe, who writes, quote, "The burden of social science evidence supports the idea that gender-differentiated parenting is important for human development and that the contribution of fathers to child-rearing is unique and irreplaceable." He then concluded, quote, "We should disavow the notion that mommies can make good daddies, just as we should disavow the popular notion that daddies can make good mommies. The two sexes are different to the core, and each is necessary culturally and biologically for the optimal development of a human being." This was in a book that Popenoe wrote back in the late 90s on fatherless America. It was when the original marriage movement was born in the 80s and the 90s, responding to high rates of out-of-wedlock childbearing, of high rates of cohabitation, of divorce, and of absentee dads. And you got books like, with titles like Fatherless America, Confronting America's Most Urgent Social Problem, because this was the concern of that original generation of marriage movement scholars. And what was interesting is that you actually had social scientists, academics, who were in favor of kind of weakening family ties and of single parenting and things like this, reconsidering in light of the data. It's when you get an Atlantic Monthly cover story with the title Dan Quayle Was Right. People who had looked at the data saw that reinventing family structures and parenting was a disaster both for women and for children. Such that Child Trends in 2003, a left-leaning think tank in DC, could conclude its research brief looking at the past 40 years of social science with this claim. "Research clearly demonstrates that family structure matters for children, and the family structure that helps the most is a family headed by two biological parents in a low-conflict marriage. Children in single-parent families, children born to unmarried mothers, and children in step-families or cohabiting relationships face higher risks of poor outcomes. There is thus value for children in promoting strong, stable marriages between biological parents." In our book and in the brief, we cite several other studies like this from places like Princeton and the University of Wisconsin, the Brookings Institution, another liberal think tank in DC. which isn't to denigrate other forms of human sociability or of human relationship, but it is to point out why the state has an interest in this particular type of human relationship and human community that we call marriage, and why marriage matters for the political community, both for the good of the spouses who enter into it and for the children who they rear within its context. James Q. Wilson, the late social scientist at Harvard and then Pepperdine, explained, quote, "Marriage is a socially arranged solution for the problem of getting people to stay together and care for children that the mere desire for children and the sex that makes children possible does not solve." We have to say that it's the least restrictive way in which a political community can ensure the well-being of future citizens. It's protecting children by incentivizing the man and the woman who created the child to commit to each other and then take responsibility for that child. And it does this while protecting everyone's liberty to live and to love how they choose. So in all 50 states, two people of the same sex can live together and love each other. They can join a liberal church and have a wedding ceremony. They can work for a progressive business and be given marriage benefits if the church chooses to and if the business chooses to. What's at stake right now is whether or not the Supreme Court will redefine marriage and then coercively, using the force of law and government, force every religious institution and every business to recognize a same-sex relationship as if it's a marriage, even if they don't think it is. So the issue of coercion works in the exact opposite way than libertarians think. Because what we've seen with respect to marriage breakdown is that when the man and the woman who created the child don't commit to each other and take responsibility for that child, government grows. And it's a coercive form of intrusive government. It taxes us higher, crime rates rise, poverty, especially child poverty, increases, and social mobility decreases. So much so that in 2008, President Obama, in his speech on the importance of fatherhood, spoke these words. "We know the statistics that children who grow up without a father are 5 times more likely to live in poverty and commit crime, 9 times more likely to drop out of schools, and 20 times more likely to end up in prison. They're more likely to have behavioral problems or run away from home and become teenage parents themselves, and the foundations of our community are weaker because of it. The Brookings Institution, a left-leaning think tank in D.C., found that $229 billion of welfare expenditures between 1970 and 1996 can be directly attributed to the breakdown of marriage in America. More recent studies that have been done in this past decade have that number figure much higher. So the question then is, if the law redefines marriage to say that fathers are optional, how can law and culture send this signal, teach the message that fathers are essential? President Obama, up until he evolved last year, understood that fathers were essential, and that's part of the reason why during his first term, at least officially, he was in favor of marriage, understood as a union of a man and a woman, a husband and a wife, a mother and a father. And what we have seen in jurisdictions that have redefined marriage, shortly thereafter, the coercive force of government have shut down Christian-run adoption agencies that thought orphans deserved both a mother and a father. And so we've seen in Massachusetts, in Illinois, and in Washington, D.C., Christian-run adoption agencies were shut down, not because they received government money, but they simply weren't even granted an adoption license. It's illegal to run an adoption agency without being licensed, and those jurisdictions said unless you place orphans on an equal footing with same-sex couples and with traditional moms and dads, you're discriminating and we will shut you down, and that's what happened. Michael tells me I'm out of time, so I will stop there. Thank you.
Hi. So, and thank you for inviting me to respond. I took this, I didn't prepare formally. I figured I would just respond to arguments that I'm in general quite familiar with and that I was interested in seeing what form they would take today. I should start by stipulating that there are many things that I agree with and what Mr. Ryan has said. And in fact, I would approach the question from almost the opposite point of view from the critiques he was making of the supposed defenders of same-sex marriage. In fact, I'm not particularly a defender of same-sex marriage, even though I have participated in supporting some of those particular cases on the grounds of civil equality. Frankly, I would be much more in favor of the disestablishment of marriage as a state function in general, and I would argue that it is not, in its essence, a state function. And I would grant all of the religions the right to govern their norms of marriage however they choose, but I wouldn't grant any citizenship rights on the basis of religion and of what I think is, in fact, in essence, a religious definition of both marriage and of human sexuality. So I really agree that marriage does not have that kind of an essence. I disagree, however, and I would agree that we need to ask the question, what right and business does the state have in getting in the business of regulating marriage? And I would suggest it doesn't and shouldn't, but that is a utopian. And so it's within the present context. I mean, if we were having an abstract conversation and if we were in a different political moment, I would make a very different kind of an argument. It's only within the context of a society that I believe mistakenly distributes so many benefits and protections through marriage, which I think it should not do, that I argue for what marriage equality in the sense that all people should have an equal right to enter the institution that I personally wish was not a state-sanctioned institution. So just to set that out from the beginning. And I also would accept the Sotomayor question and the challenge, what should limit it to two and why should it be monogamous? Nothing, in my view, gives the state that particular interest. I think the state does have a very serious interest in a lot of other things that marriage has historically done and can do, but that I don't think only marriage can do, and that we shouldn't require that it all be based on marriage. So I disagree then with the fundamental definition of marriage, the idea that you can define for all time what marriage has been, what it is, and what it will be, especially since in my imagination it might someday be returned again to a state in which it is not a function of the state. In particular, the idea that marriage is fundamentally about procreation, which is in essence what this argument presumes. The kind of philosophical notion of a union of bodies, hearts, and minds presumes a very particular kind of union of particular bodies, heterosexual bodies, based on the notion of procreation. But we know, of course, that we don't require procreative capacity on the part of anyone who enters marriage. Well, infertility is not grounds for being denied a marriage license. Being postmenopausal is not grounds for being denied a marriage license in the state. And if that were in fact the primary reason for marriage, then there's no reason at all that anyone who is infertile or who is past the age of child rearing or the capacity should be allowed within that institution. I think I have never heard a good explanation on the other side, and I would like to hear one, of why this is crucial. Homosexual bodies can unite sexually, not in a way that creates procreation, but the fact is that procreation in this period no longer does depend on heterosexual union. We just had the death of the doctor who led to the Louise Brown birth of the first in vitro fertilization in the age, and you don't need very high tech. In fact, it was even accomplished back in the Old Testament. You can have and did have forms of surrogacy. It is very, very possible for sperm to be delivered to an ovum without heterosexual union, and is happening. So I don't think that that holds up anymore, even if it once did. And even when it once did, it is not the case that all cultures and all societies and even all religions were fundamentally in agreement about what marriage was. Certainly, marriage was never about love, romance, and a deep emotional commitment between two individuals. Historically, it was about linking kinships systems. It was about it was about property. It was indeed about heirs, which in a period when heirs really meant labor force and security for the old age of the parents, and a very important social security system at that. But it simply is untrue that it was expected that the couple would make each other their primary commitment. Often they had no choice in the matter, or very little choice. And many of the world's religions have had arranged marriage systems, plural marriage systems. Up through the 19th century, a majority of the world's family systems in different cultures actually were polygamous rather than monogamous. So there is nothing inherent in marriage that requires that. I'm not arguing for those other forms, though I do in my book argue for the decriminalization of polygamy, which I think is a deeply hypocritical stance, and we could get into that if you want. But it's not because I'm advocating polygamy, far from it. In fact, I'm not advocating any one particular form of relationship. I'm advocating equal justice support for all of the actual families that we have in our society today. I can and will dispute at great length all of the so-called social science that Mr. Anderson presented, particularly the citations to Popano, Barbara Whitehead's article in the Atlantic Monthly, and Obama, who certainly is not a social scientist and was deeply misled. And I have published a couple of articles that have reviewed all of the research on that. Notice that none of those comparisons about the disadvantages to children and the scare tactics around fatherlessness included same-sex couple parents from the get-go in the studies. That research is entirely comparing single parents to married couple parents, and it is not a legitimate comparison. And I've taken apart in the research with Tim Biblars the conflation of marital status, the number of parents, one versus two, and the gender of parents and the sexual orientation of parents. In fact, there is very good evidence that was not discussed or evaluated at all in any of those research outfits that shows that children who have two committed same-sex parents from the get-go turn out at least as well as children from heterosexual couple families. And in my own study, interestingly enough, I actually believe, we don't have the data on this yet, but I suspect for the reasons of selection, what we call selection effects, that the children of gay male co-parents will wind up having probably the best parents. And that is not because I think there's something best about being gay or male in being a parent, but it's because of the difficulty involved and the self-selection, therefore, of the level of commitment and of desire for children. There are no accidental children at all in that sort of a situation. I can go over the research on fatherlessness. It's wildly distorting of the reality. And there certainly is no evidence that the states that have legalized same-sex marriage have lower heterosexual marriage rates. In fact, quite the opposite. One of the ironies is that the so-called red states, the states that are most opposed to same-sex marriage, most involved in religious ideology around family and the marriage campaign and the marriage promotion movements, are actually the states with the lowest marriage rates, the highest divorce rates, and the highest rates of children born outside of marriage. Massachusetts has one of the stablest marriage cultures in the country, ironically. The blue states are much more stable. And it isn't because of you have to be very careful when you use correlational data, but it in my view, that is because it correlates. What correlates for the best outcomes for children are, in fact, stability and the education, especially of the primary parent, which is usually a mother. And it's very, very interesting that all of those scare tactics about five times, Obama was dead wrong. He was quoting studies that are, and I'm glad he's finally realized that, though I don't know how much he's actually realized that. But the research does not show that at all, and I can show you in every single case what was wrong with the study. The most cited in that regard is Sarah McLanahan. No same-sex couples at all were included in that research, so it doesn't speak to the issue in any way, shape, or form. So I would say that children certainly do not need both a mother and a father. They need good parents of whatever sort. two good parents who have a low conflict relationship and a long-term commitment are decidedly better than one, but one good parent with a stable commitment and good education is much better than two who don't have those resources and who don't get along. And it is not family structure in and of itself, though structure has some role to play. There is no evidence, for example, that three parents would not be better than two. We have no studies whatsoever that examine that. But I think that we could have such studies because there are now people making that sort of a commitment through collaborative forms of parenting, and I talk about polyparenting a bit in the book Unhitched. I can also introduce you to other family systems in the world that didn't depend on marriage, and I write about the Maasai people, the an ethnic minority in southwestern China. Where am I on time so far?
Oh, all right.
Well, great. So there is the Maasai culture in the Yunnan province of southwestern China is a family culture that historically did not include marriage at all. There was no assumption that children needed to be raised by their own biological mother and father. Instead, it's a matrilineal, matrilocal, extended family household system in which adult children, brothers and sisters, remain in the maternal home, a compound, through adulthood. And basically, children are raised by the mothers and her sisters and brothers and three, four generational families. And in other words, the uncles are the social fathers. And paternity is irrelevant. It's a heterosexual system of night visiting, and women have a room of their own and men do not. Men go out visiting women at night. They can have long-term exclusive relationships. They can have multiple fathers. All of the children born to all of the women of the family belong to that family and are raised by that family. Those children do extremely well, are perfectly well adjusted, and do not need to be raised by their own monogamous, exclusive, heterosexual mother and father. We have no research, by the way, on the effects of sexual exclusivity or not on children. It's mainly a social prejudice, maybe one that most of us share, but it is not based on social science research because no study has ever been done of that, interestingly enough. And we can talk also about plural marriage systems. I argue for decriminalization because I think we do much more harm by criminalizing it, but I don't think there would ever be a big demand for polygamy, which should be gender neutral, which it has never been. It's almost always been polygyny, one man with multiple wives. And I make some interesting arguments reversing the slippery slope. In order to maintain the kind of an image or a vision that Mr. Anderson put forth, you would basically have to almost eliminate, make divorce almost impossible. Because in fact, we have a marriage system now that is really only for as long as the partners still want it. And that is not because people suddenly woke up one day and changed their mind about centuries-old traditions. It has to do with very significant economic, political, and social transformations that are irreversible. By the way, I just read the other day that Yugoslavia just legalized same-sex marriage. France is on the verge of doing so. New Zealand is on the verge of doing so. We will soon be up to about 15 nations. Interestingly, four or five of them predominantly Catholic nations. And one of the ironies is that it's very likely that the Republic of Ireland will legalize same-sex marriage long before it's legal in all 50 states in the United States. Now that's in fact a product of much more of our system, our constitutional system that perhaps unfortunately, that's open to interesting discussion, delegates family law primarily to the states. And that's why we have the culture wars, in my view, as a sociologist, and why we have the family wars, and why we have this patchwork ridiculous, incongruent set of laws about family that can define marriage and sexual norms and everything else differently across 50 states, and at great burden to people who lose rights by crossing a state line, and we get a lot of increasingly certain forms of migration based on that. I don't think that's in any way helpful. And it also allows, especially because of the gerrymandering drawing of electoral districts, for extreme positions, which I believe this is, to be very mobilizing emotional issues in particular jurisdictions unrelated to what the national sentiment is. I mean, it's really interesting that at this point in time, a majority of evangelical Christian youth in this society support same-sex marriage. So, you know, the tide, I mean, I don't think it's a question of, I think this is a kind of an atavistic debate. Same-sex marriage will be legal in the society. It's been a question of when, not if, for a long time. And it's also a question of how. I suspect that the Supreme Court will overturn DOMA, as I think they should, because I really genuinely believe that is unconstitutional, given the Constitution's delegation, correctly or incorrectly, of family law to the states. I think they probably will go for a procedural reading on the Prop 8 case, which is fine with me. I don't need a broad ruling at this point in time. And I would accept the questions that Mr. Anderson raised. I think in the last instance, there is no way to define marriage to maintain it as an exclusive heterosexual monogamous institution without relying on religion, even if religion isn't spoken. I don't agree that that is a case that's based on any other principle than a deep religious and moral belief that that is somehow superior. But even in its own terms, I cannot imagine how denying the right to marriage to same-sex couples will do anything to increase the number of children who are living with stable, committed parents. It certainly won't do that for the children of same-sex couples. And it isn't going to lead more heterosexual couples to get married because same-sex couples cannot. It is not going to do anything for the children who are already in same-sex married, same-sex couple co-parent families, and it's not going to stop people with homosexual desires and the desire to parent from becoming parents. So I can't see one good thing that it actually would accomplish for the benefit of children. Now, what I would like to see, I accept the challenge, why should marriage be sexual? Well, I say, why should there be marriage at all? I think what there should be are committed, responsible people who are willing to join their resources and commitments to take care of dependents. Children, the elderly, which is something increasingly on my mind, and other dependents, and that people who are willing to make those commitments. So I would agree that we should get rid of the sexual family. There's no reason in the contemporary world to base our relationships necessarily on sex. And Lord knows many of us who have been married know that marriage is rarely mainly about sex, even if that's what sparked it to begin with. And so I think there are some very powerful questions to answer here, and I'd be happy to discuss any of the studies if you're interested or that on my return.
Okay, so in my 10 minutes, I'll try to respond to some of that. There was a lot of excellent material put on the table, so it'll be hard to cover it all. I think I'll start by saying what we agree on. Professor Stacey and I agree that if you say that sexual complementarity is arbitrary, then everything else about marriage law in America, as we have known it in the past two centuries, is arbitrary as well. So if you're a justice on the Supreme Court and you accept Professor Stacey's argument, then not just the expectation that marriage is a male-female relationship, but everything else about marriage law will also be arbitrary. The expectation of permanency, monogamy, sexual exclusivity, all of that stands or falls together. The difference is I think it should stand. Professor Stacey thinks it should fall. But regardless of what you might think of the morality of group marriage or polygamous marriage or sexually open marriage or temporary marriage, it would be a disaster for the state's interest in marriage, what gets the government involved in marriage policy in the first place. The government's interest in marriage is having the man and the woman who create a child commit to each other and take care of that child. But if the sexual norms that govern adult sexual activity is based on nothing more than consent and non-deception, whether it between two people or 10 people, whether it be a sexually open or sexually closed relationship, whether it be a permanent relationship or a temporary relationship, how can the state get what it needs out of marriage, which is ensuring that children have their rights protected, their right to the love and the care of the man and the woman, the mother and the father who created them? That's what marriage does for a political community. That's why the United States has been in the marriage business for the past two centuries. But if you redefine marriage to say that the male-female aspect is arbitrary, then you undercut everything else about marriage. And we already know what the social harms are of undercutting that. That's what we saw during the past 40 years of increase in crime, an increase in prison population, increase in poverty, especially child poverty, increase in welfare costs, decrease in social mobility. So everything that you could care about, if you care about social justice, if you care about limited government, is better served by a strong marriage culture with an expectation that a man and a woman should commit to each other permanently and exclusively and then take responsibility for their children than it would be by having adults just live by J.S. Mill's harm principle. Let's see, where to go next with this. The social science that she mentioned, I want to read a passage of an amicus brief that Harvey Mansfield from Harvard University and Leon Cass from the University of Chicago filed with the Supreme Court. They write, even if same-sex marriage and child-rearing by same-sex couples were far more common than they now are, large amount of data collected over decades would be required before any responsible researcher could make meaningful scientific estimates of the effects. They went on to say that there could conceivably come a time when supporters of traditional marriage are compelled by scientific evidence to acknowledge that same-sex marriage is not harmful for children or to society at large. That day is not here, and there is not the slightest reason to think it is imminent. They then cited Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan, a Democrat from New York who is a professor at Harvard, who said that social science is rarely dispassionate and social scientists frequently are caught up in politics. Lastly, they concluded, claims that science provides support for constitutionalizing a right to same-sex marriage must necessarily rest on ideology. Ideology may be persuasive in the social sciences, especially when controversially policy issues are at stake, but ideology is not science. Professor Stacey's own research admits that there's not a single study of gay parenting from conception on. There's one study of gay adoptive parenting, but not a single study of gay parenting. This is what she reported in 2010 and which we cite in our book. And yet today, just minutes ago, she told you that she expects that gay parents will be the best parents of all. On the basis of what science? What we do have is a 40-year, more or less, consensus among social scientists at places like Princeton in Wisconsin, so liberal, secular, major research universities, at think tanks like the Brookings Institution and Child Trends, liberal think tanks in DC, that even up to this day, just last week, Brookings hosted an event on the importance of marriage for children and for women, that completely disagrees with Judith Stacey's revisionist account of social science. On this, there simply isn't much of a disagreement among social scientists, and Professor Stacey is in a minority in this position. You can get more or less social scientists left, right, and center agreeing that the family structure that's best for children is a married family between biological parents. And it's right that they didn't compare this to same-sex parenting relationships simply because it was scientifically impossible. There are too few, and so far we have only two studies that have looked at same-sex parenting in with large representative samples. And both of those have shown worse outcomes for children on a host of indices. The studies that Professor Stacey does refer to have been convenient samples, snowball samples, small samples full of biases, non-representative samples. And you can read Lauren Mark's article in the most recent summer issue of Social Science Research, which the editor has affirmed is a good piece of scholarship, and you can read Mark Regneris' study on this. which one of the commenters commented saying that this is the best that we can hope for as far as social science today can go. So if we're going to reject these studies, we just have to reject all of the social science, which then gets us back to the philosophical question of what is marriage, and why is the government in the marriage business, and what contours should our marriage law take? We haven't heard a word from Professor Stacey on that, except to say that she thinks all people should be treated equally with respect to civil marriage, without ever telling us what civil marriage is, and why they should be treating couples equally according to civil marriage would demand redefining marriage to include same-sex relationships, but not other forms of human relationship, or why the expectation of male-female sexual complementarity is arbitrary, unjust, and irrational. We haven't had an argument about that, but we have had an assertion that anyone that thinks marriage is between a man and a woman is arguing solely from religion. That would be interesting for Plato and Aristotle and Cicero and Plutarch and Musenius Rufus and Kant. What religious traditions were they arguing from? They didn't have access to Judaism or Christianity. Kant's an Enlightenment thinker. You could argue that he's arguing solely from Christianity, but I don't think that would bear the test of his actual writings. I'm not sure whether Gandhi's views of marriage were also solely coming from the Judeo-Christian tradition. It's actually remarkable that while most major world revisions disagree on most things, on the question of marriage being a male-female institution, they've always agreed on this. And that suggests that there's something natural, there's something about human nature that makes marriage a male-female institution. So the argument that I made from history is not that polygamy hasn't existed. It's not that different cultures haven't recognized marriage in slightly different ways. It's that every political community and religious community that we know of up until the year 2000 recognized marriage as a male-female relationship. Whatever else they thought about marriage, they all thought it was a male-female relationship. On the numbers, Professor Stacey said that we're approaching 50 jurisdictions outside of the United States that recognize same-sex marriage.
15.
Oh, 15. Okay, great. Because I was going to say, as of January, it was only 12. I was wondering, how did we get so high? So 15. So out of the several hundred political communities represented in the United Nations, as of January, only 12 recognize same-sex marriage. There is no historical groundswell of support. To say that young evangelicals today are in support would just be the same as saying when Roe v. Wade came out, the Southern Baptists were in favor of abortion. People forget this, but at the time in America, Southern Baptists were okay with Roe. Now they're the religious community most pro-life. At the time, all of the experts and the academic elites said that pro-lifers were on the wrong side of history and that it's just a matter of time. And now my generation is more pro-life than Professor Stacey's generation. And that the most recent Gallup polls show that the majority of Americans are pro-life. History isn't a blind force in which we're passive observers. We're the active participants in history, and we will shape history. Lastly, she raised the question of same-sex parenting and the law. The concern here is not that a handful of gay or lesbian couples are going to be snatching up kids and raising them in dysfunctional ways. That's not the concern. Although that should be a concern given recent legislation in California about cost-free fertility treatments for same-sex couples. California has recently introduced legislation that says that a same-sex couple should receive under the state's healthcare cost-free fertility treatment. So what this would do is it would create a child from the get-go to be deprived of half of its genetic identity, either its mother or its father. But the real concern is what the law will teach. And so I'll conclude by saying that the law taught something 40 years ago when it redefined marriage the first time with no-fault divorce. Under common law, marriage could be dissolved for three A's, abuse, abandonment, and adultery. And you would sue, citing fault for divorce, my spouse abuses me, he abandoned me, he committed adultery. And you had reason, serious reason, to end a marriage. With the introduction of no-fault divorce, the law now taught that marriage need not even have an expectation to permanency. You can get out of marriage for any reason or no reason at all. And what we've seen 40 years later is that divorce rates went from near single digits to approaching 50%. And the consequence of this, in terms of broken hearts and broken homes, the consequences especially for the American children who have grown up without fathers, have been devastating. If we redefine marriage again to say that fathers are optional, how will the law teach that fathers are essential?
Well, we do agree that if you have to stipulate that sexual complementarity in terms of heterosexual intercourse is the fundamental basis for marriage, then there's no conversation, because I don't accept that. I mean, I accept that you can call marriage whatever you want, but as I already said, I don't expect, I don't prefer that the state do privilege marriage. So I'm not trying to make an argument that that should be the basis. And again, we heard that the government's interest in marriage is in the child, but we didn't hear any call to prohibit marriage among infertile couples, postmenopausal women, et cetera. So if there is reason to allow people who cannot procreate to get married, then it is not because there is some biological capacity for creating a life that you have to stay together and raise together. And the entire case breaks down on that basis. I can see no way around that. Either that is the definition of marriage or it is not. As far as I'm concerned, I would have a, I don't need to hold on to marriage, but to the extent that state benefits and protections for children and for relationships of property, what's been left out of this a lot is property. Historically, marriage has had as much to do with maintaining property relations, political lineages. Often there were political strategies involved in assigning women to marriage. Most marriage systems through most of history have been patriarchal. Mr. Anderson smuggles love into the definition, talking about the mother and father who love that child. That would have given the Puritans some pause. The notion that love was a central value in child rearing is a very historically specific one. And while it's one that I personally might like and share and hope that I lived up to in my own parenting, it is not something that is transcultural, transhistorical. It's also the case that there have been cultures that did allow and even require at times same-sex marriage. There have been cultures in indigenous cultures in the pre-United States that had a woman-woman marriage. There have been parts of India that had woman-woman marriage. These were not expected usually to be sexual, though there also have been cultures that had more than two genders and did allow women to live as men and have wives. So the world is a very complicated place. Family, the world has always had marital diversity, and it's also had non-marriage and family diversity. Family diversity is here to stay. I do think that the topic of abortion is an interesting one, and we could go, but I don't want to address that in my time here today, the shift in values. I think that has had a lot to do with the rise in children being born outside of wedlock, reversal in opinions on that. But I don't think we're going to see a similar reversal when it comes to support for equality to same-sex couples as to others. A lot of divorce in the pre-Stonewall period, not a lot of divorce because it's not a high percentage, but for those who had homoerotic desires, and I knew many of them, many people falsely, like former Governor McGreevy in New Jersey, entered heterosexual marriages trying to stay in the closet and trying to struggle against and hide their genuine desires, and those marriages often broke up and led to other kinds of relationships. So I do think that the basic premises are deeply flawed. To go back to the social science, it seems that Mr. Anderson wants to have it both ways. On the one hand, he tells us what the best study is, which is the most flawed study that there are now many, many people, including the predominant social scientists and pediatricians in the country, calling for its retraction. This Regnerus study, which is, there's a lot you can read about that, the family structure study, which is, I totally agree that there is no such thing as social science that is completely free of ideology, nor do I think there's a human being or a lawyer or a judge on the Supreme Court or a lawyer who is completely free of ideology. The point is to own your ideology and to display your methods and to own your definitions and allow those to be replicated challenged, examined by people from different perspectives. And so I don't think you can have it both ways and say that Regnerus is the very best, and quote the one person out of eight commentators that said that was a good study, where there were many critical of it. The review process for that particular article was so flawed that some of the people involved in designing and in funding the study were involved in the review. It was rushed into print in something like 3 to 6 weeks. It's a bit of a scandal within the social science format. And it did not study children who were raised by same-sex couples. It defined it was a statistical survey, but it was a survey that asked children if their parents had ever been involved in a same-sex relationship during their childhood, which completely compounds, as Regnerus himself acknowledges, it is not a study of gay parenting in any way, shape, or form. When he said that I myself said that there have been no studies, or that there are no studies of gay parents who've raised children from the get-go, there are many studies of lesbians who have done that, and they are very good studies. They are not just convenient samples. In fact, there are some that have been a total sample of all of the couples, heterosexual and lesbian, that use the same fertility center and match them for comparable background. In the Netherlands, where same-sex marriage is legal, and some studies in Belgium of that sort too, and a little bit in England. And in child development studies, statistical studies are not very helpful because they do not allow you ever to establish causality or to watch the process. Most child development work is done by matching samples as well as you can. However, I don't want to get mainly into the social science argument about this. But the idea that because Obama once mistakenly said that fathers are essential, it is so, is simply not the case. If it was essential, then all children who were raised without a father would be at serious disadvantage. And yet we've had many presidents, including Obama, who were raised in just that form. So I always thought it was particularly ironic that he would have bought that. Meanwhile, the American Sociological Association, the American Pediatric Association, the American Psychological Association, the American Psychiatric Association, all have come out in support both of same-sex marriage and of the claims that parents, that children do just as well in the who are parented from the beginning by same-sex couples. So it is not the case that leading social scientists, in fact, if it were the case, there would have been some better expert witnesses in the Prop 8 case. It was only David Blankenhorn, who is not a social scientist at all and who was decimated on the stand and ultimately reversed his position on same-sex marriage, that the people in favor of Prop 8 were able to produce an expert witness. All of the expert witnesses on the other side were enormously pedigreed, and I could name them if there were time.
Thank you. So we're going to go ahead and open the floor to questions. We've got about 12 minutes for that. In the back.
So I had a question and a comment for Mr. Anderson. The comment, real quick, is I heard a lot about divorce. I heard a lot about father being essential. I heard a little bit about adoption. It sounds to me like your efforts and your book should be focused on Madonna, who is, I believe, a single mother adopting children in Malawi right now, than same-sex couples who want to come together and raise a child with two parents. So I would just suggest to you that that may be a more fruitful project than the one you're working on right now. The question, though, is to take on your point about throuples, because I want to really kind of see how you respond. It seems to me that the essential difference between a union of two people and something like a throuple would be the question of choice. So, you know, as a heterosexual male, I have the choice of entering in a relationship with a woman, right? And I don't think I have the choice of entering a relationship in with a man because I'm heterosexual. Nor do I think I have the choice of entering in a relationship with two other people because that's not the law. But more importantly, if I really wanted to enter that relationship with three people, the government would have an interest in saying no and would be justified in it because they're not preventing the choice of entering in any kind of marriage. But what's happening right now is by denying same-sex marriage, you're telling homosexual people that they can't enter into the institution of marriage at all. So it seems to me that's the essential difference between denying one form of a marriage to a throuple versus denying marriage entirely to a class of people, gays and lesbians.
Sure. I mean, it's a great question. I mean, I think it begs the question. You're begging the question of what marriage is, and you're begging the question of orientation. So I could easily just turn around and say, why are you denying the right of polysexual Americans to enter into a poly marriage?
Does that mean people
who are polysexual? Who have an innate desire towards multi-sexual partners, multiple sexual partners. Their sexual orientation is towards two people, or three people, or four people.
And they're only attracted to multiple people at once?
Well, I mean, it seems to me that it hasn't yet been studied by the social scientists.
I'm just saying, I've never even heard of it, whereas I can tell you, there are lots of gay people I know in my life, in this school, in this city. You probably know gay people.
We all do. So let me rephrase it this way. Whether they're only attracted or not, their preferred relationship type, the relationship type that brings them most joy and happiness in life, is with more than one person. What principle of law? Why are you denying them their marriage equality? It seems to me that we can only answer that question by first answering what marriage is. And so we're not denying, I don't think we're denying someone who's attracted to someone of the same sex a marriage any more than we're denying someone who's attracted to multiple people a marriage, if what marriage is a monogamous, sexually exclusive relationship of sexually complementary spouses. So you would first have to engage that argument about why that's not what marriage is, and then propose an alternative definition, understanding of what marriage is. And if you want to say it's just, you know, your number one best person, like Corvino does, we could go down that road, but then you would need to explain what's magical about the number one, or what's magical about the number two, for two people. But also, I don't think we're denying anyone, when you said it's all about choice. Everyone in America, it's actually interesting here, same-sex couples are free to choose to live and to love how they choose. Polygamy is actually illegal in some jurisdictions. So it's actually, you can go to jail for practicing polygamy. You can't go to
jurisdictions, by the way.
Is it now all?
I know
some don't recognize polygamous marriages. I didn't know that all had criminalized polygamous relationships. So you can go to jail for being in a polygamous relationship. You can't go to jail for being in a same-sex relationship. So again, I think the choice element cuts the other way. I want to say two other things, though. I don't think it's surprising that we see politicized groups of academics speaking out in favor of same-sex marriage, even when they don't have the data to support their conclusions. So Professor Stacey mentioned the American Academy of Pediatricians. This group of pediatricians also has issued statements on how we should balance the budget and which handguns ought to be illegal. Again, this isn't an objective organization of social scientists or pediatricians. It's a left-wing advocacy group. And that's why, you know, they don't say, there's also a conservative group of pediatricians which filed an amicus brief. They didn't get any media attention. It's not surprising that the left-wing ones do. If you think the Mark Regnerus study is an inadequate piece of social science research, then every piece of social science research that we have is inadequate. So again, you can't have it both ways. Saying that we have studies that look at the same fertility clinic, looking at all people that went to this fertility clinic, is not a representative sample. That compounds the bias. And so we've looked at the studies that we do have. They tend to be of upper middle class, dual income white lesbians from urban areas like Manhattan and San Francisco. From that sample, you can conclude absolutely nothing about what same-sex parenting looks like as a representative phenomenon of Americans in general. You would have to have a random representative sample to draw conclusions about the population as a whole. Lastly, I don't think it's ironic at all that President Obama has spoken out on the importance of fathers, precisely because he experienced what it was like growing up without a father. That's what compels him to speak about the importance of fathers, and it's what inspires him to be a good father to his daughters. So far from being ironic, I actually think it reveals a profound truth about the human condition. I think he's just echoing the academic consensus.
But then if that's what made him a good father, then you're saying fatherlessness is the path to successful fatherhood. That doesn't make a lot of sense.
As you know, social science works on average for the most part. It doesn't deal, it's not like a law of chemistry. It's not as if because you grow up without a father, you're doomed and destined to failure. But what the social science shows is that on average, for the most part, children who experience the absence of a father do suffer negative outcomes. And that's what President Obama was citing when he cited the statistics, that they're 5 times more likely to live in poverty. It's not that they're all going to live in poverty. They're 5 times more likely. They're 9 times more likely to commit crime. It's not that all of them are going to be criminals, but they're 9 times more likely to commit crime. That's what the social science shows, and that's how social science works. It's different than the hard sciences like physics. It's not a direct cause and effect like billiard balls.
Well, you have other questions, why don't we do that?
Yeah, I'm going to ask you some questions about the philosophical account of marriage you present. You seem to be rooting...
It's okay, let's limit to one question. Is that okay? Just time.
So you have a vaguely Aristotelian account of marriage, and I wanted to argue that Aristotle also had a very essentialist view of not just marriages, but also political institutions, famously stating that not only that the natural form of society founded one particular type, the Greek city-state, which for many reasons we have decided to reject Aristotle's very essentialist definition of social institutions such as the city-state. I think that's universal among Christian thinkers as well in terms of... So I was wondering what motivates you to adopt the essentialist view of why we can maintain Aristotle's essentialist view or Aristotelian thinking of marriage while discarding Aristotle's essentialist view of political structures, and why doesn't that impact your philosophical conception of marriage as a whole?
Yeah, so this is a great question. Lots of thinkers had profound insights into human reality while also having profound flaws. So Aristotle also defended natural slavery, and we don't. We think he made a mistake about that. Aristotle also defended certain forms of sexism. We think he made a mistake about that. We think that the tools that he gives us for analyzing communities are actually really, really helpful because they're really insightful. It's not right what you reported about his view of the Greek city-state being the only form of political community. If you read through the Politics, all of those boring middle books is his tautology of all of the other forms of political community in existence. What Aristotle gave us was a way of looking and categorizing them through a focal case paradigm, in which the focal case of political community might be something like the Greek polis, but then there would be other cases of political community that were in different ways deficient. And then he identifies, you know, the lesser forms of political community. You know, he hit up the good forms, monarchy, polity, aristocracy, and then he has the bad forms, right? So he has tyranny, and he has oligarchy, and then he has democracy, which he thinks is mob rule, right? So again, he has a very sophisticated analysis. He identifies at least 6 different forms of governance. But then he does analyze them and puts them in a hierarchical ordering, and he shows how we move from one to the other, how the corruptions lead to the varying forms. Again, you don't have to agree with everything Aristotle says to think that he had some insights into human analysis. The last thing I'll mention there is that Aristotle, like other thinkers who shared this view of marriage, never thought that infertility was an obstacle to marriage. And that the history, infertility has never really been viewed by either canon law or civil law as an impediment to marriage. And so that's why I didn't respond to it. I actually thought Professor Stacey was joking when she mentioned it in her original presentation, because this is a red herring that has been responded to time and time again by people who share my view. It's in the article that we published in the Harvard Journal of Law and Policy. It has an entire chapter in the book that we published. It's in the amicus brief that we filed with the Supreme Court. And so it's almost as if to say that you haven't heard a response to the infertility objection is either just, you know, you're joking, or it's willful ignorance. Two people, a man and a woman, can unite in a sexual act that actually unifies them as a single organism, regardless of whether conception takes place hours later and regardless of whether a child is born 9 months later. The type of union that they can form is based upon the action that they perform, which is why in both civil law and canon law, impotency, the inability to unite conjugally, has been viewed as an impediment to marriage and grounds for an annulment. Not grounds for divorce, but both civil law and canon law. This was reason for declaring a marriage never took place. Likewise, sodomitical acts between heterosexual partners were never understood to consummate a marriage. to consummate a marriage between a man and a woman, it had to be coital union. So even if the heterosexual partners engaged in anal or oral sex, in the eyes of the law, that didn't actually consummate the marriage. And that reveals something that the law was tracking, the human reality, that what unites the spouses as one flesh, in the language of the Hebrew scriptures, was conjugal union. And that's what we're arguing here. And fertility rates doesn't affect that at all for a real marriage reform. What gets the state interested in this is the reality that the vast majority of men are fertile up until their death. So when Elena Kagan asked this question during oral arguments on Tuesday of Prop 8, and she kept getting the audience to laugh, so she drowned out Chuck Cooper's answer. But Chuck Cooper gave an answer about why the state has an interest even in the 55-year-old man who gets married. If he remains faithful to his spouse, he's not creating fragmented families and fatherless kids with his secretary. So even from the state's perspective of why you would want to recognize infertile marriages, and the example that Kagan gave was that's a couple over the age of 55, so you don't have to worry about violations of privacy. His response was that even for that man, he, by him being monogamous and sexually exclusive, he's not creating fragmented families, and it advances the state interest. Plus, it has none of the negatives because it doesn't send a contrary signal that marriage is more about the desires of adults and the needs of children, or that marriage is something that doesn't take male and female mothers and fathers seriously.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah, and I responded to that, and then
not very well.
Hey, I'm sorry you think that.
Afterward, guys, I'm so sorry, but unfortunately we do have to give up the room. Thank you so much for being here. Could we give one more round of applause to both of you?